fall ill, and now they may not even die well. So there's this conclusion that they don't want to become a Hong Konger in their next life. Mr. Leung Che-cheung, Mr. Chairman, oh sorry, Mr. President, let me say something about universal retirement protection on this welfare subject. The focus of this year's policy address is still on universal retirement protection, which has been discussed for years. For the PA's description and conclusion, we can only say that we are both delighted and disappointed. For preparation for the future, $20 billion have been reserved. That's the delighted part. The saddening or disappointing part is that no decision has yet been made, and consultation will only commence in the latter half of this year. As Professor Nelson Charles said, the road is long for implementing universal retirement protection. In 1995, there was this motion for MPF, which was implemented in the year 2000. So it took 6 years for us to implement MPF. And now the MPF has been in place for 15 years. Still, it is continuously undergoing modifications. And we still lack a universal retirement protection scheme to benefit the vast majority of the public. Yes, we understand that we cannot attain a perfect scheme overnight, but we propose that you opt for the easier option first. In 2011, we proposed an old age pension scheme. That is, on the basis of the OA and the OALA, a higher amount of cash subsidy be offered to the poor elderly. And this three-tier protection system has a very good advantage. Members of the public are familiar with the existing policies. So if we follow on the existing path, the government need not explain so much to the public or spend a great deal of energy on conducting studies. And our proposal can be implemented very soon. And originally, all eligible elderly reaching the age of 65 will benefit. And now we are suggesting a higher subsidy for them. In order that resources are reasonably and rationally distributed, we have suggested an option that is easy in terms of financing and acceptable to society. And after a period of implementation in accordance with the actual circumstances, we can make improvement and perfect the system.
As a matter of fact, given the aging population, we need more than just financial assistance. I learned from the newspaper about a 60-year-old, an elderly person losing his life. A 60-year-old filial son has been serving, has been looking after his 80-year-old mother. The 80-year-old slipped in the toilet, and he tried to save her, but then they passed out together in the bathroom, and nobody knew about it until the stench wafted outside the premises. The population is getting older. Those above 60 will go up from 13% to 28% in 2026, and there will be elderly people all over Hong Kong. And I'm sure that it is likely that we will see more home accidents and casualties in the days to come because of the aging demographics, and the government should look after the interests of the elderly population. The most urgent need, and indeed the government will be able to afford, is to have a requirement where safety railings should be installed in toilets, in public sector housing, and there should also be a panic button to be installed. The security guards should also pay particular attention to the elderly people, and I'm sure that that would save a lot of lives. As regards childcare, the elderly and children are most in need of care and attention, and children are going to be the pillar of our society in future. The government does have the responsibility there. It cannot shirk its responsibility. In the policy address, and there is a whole string of measures to strengthen the childcare, like the childcare centers operating hours are lengthened, and there is also a whole day care, but the number of places is nowhere near meeting the demand. Between 0 and 3, well, this age group is particularly in demand. In 2012 to 13, the utilization rate of the childcare center hit 90 to 100%. There are some residents who told me that over the weekends, on public holidays, it is hard for them to find carers to look after their kids. There is a shortfall of childcare places. A lot of parents will have to rely on the nannies in the community, but they are working on a part-time basis. They're making anything between $18 and $22 per hour, and more like working as volunteers. They're housewives themselves, and they would prioritize their families first. There were women who used community nannies who said that the nannies would refuse to stay into the evening because they have to do the cooking at home, and sometimes they would take a day off without proper notice because they have to attend their kids' school activities, and then these women have to take their time off work, and eventually some of them decided to quit their job and stay at home looking after their kids. So childcare facilities should be improved. What the government has to do is to increase the number of childcare places. There should be flexi hours in terms of the opening hours of the childcare centers. The neighborhood program is launched with the best of intention because the nannies would be able to plug the gap. But the quality of service has to be improved. Like, for instance, the hourly rate has to be improved so that they're more committed to quality service, and they will not leave their job without proper notice. In districts where there is a greater demand, Yunlong, Tuinmun, for instance, the government can take full advantage of the lower floors of these housing estates and rent them out to the NGOs for the services to be provided. They can be non-urgent or nighttime childcare services to help those working parents. As regards women joining the workforce, Mr. President, well, the reason why there is such a huge demand for childcare service is because a lot of women would still like to carry on working, and they don't really want to be divorced from the community, not to mention making a bit more money. Now, unless they are able to hire domestic helpers, or they are lucky enough to have someone helping them, it is unachievable for many women. There are some newspaper reports that suggested in 2013, those women between 25 and 54, the workforce participation rate is 71.6%, lower than Sweden, Canada, France, and the US, which register 80%. In these countries, the number of women working is higher because the government offers good support services. In Australia and European countries, many corporations allow women to work half a day, and they can work 3 days a week, or in some cases, they work between 10 and 4 in a day, so that they have more time to be with their children. Hong Kong has part-time offers as well, but a lot of them involves cleaning and distributing flyers. They are low-skilled categories. For higher-skilled jobs, these part-time jobs would be very hard to come by. And working mothers have to juggle between work and family life. So the government has to review the population policy to bring in the half-day work for working women. The government should take the lead and set a good example for the private sector so that we can release the women manpower for women to join the workforce. Thank you. Mr. Michael Tin. President, I'm dressed like this today because I'm really keen to send my New Year greeting, early greetings, and to the President and the secretaries and the people of Hong Kong. I wish that in the year of the Ram, Hong Kong will be full of joy, and in the community, the stakeholders will be really gentle, and there is good vibes in our community. President, how many young people do you think have read the policy address or show concerns? The government doesn't seem to understand the young people or the other way around. There is the Young People Development Fund in the policy address. It sounds really lovely, but it is very airy-fairy, only $300 million. It's going to be run by NGOs. Conceptually, I find it really hard to understand. It is not a charity item. It is an outsider leading the insiders. There is a likelihood that resources might be misplaced. I don't think this is a bad thing with the best of intention, but at least they cannot do anything good. Now, Jack Ma has set up a $1 billion entrepreneur fund for young people in Hong Kong. In terms of details, in terms of the operation, the Young People Development Fund pale by comparison into insignificance. The Alibaba Fund will inject funding into Hong Kong. The investment proceeds that will be plowed back to the fund for continuous investment in old projects. In the long run, it's going to help young people to develop value-added business. I agree with some members in their criticism of the Young People Development Fund. It's going to be one-off, and it is minuscule. It is nowhere near enough. We will only encourage the low value-added in the projects, the government should consider working with the business sector instead of the NGOs. And there are some private equity funds and that are performing impressively. Jack Ma did say that if you believe in the future, you have to have faith in the young people. If you want to get hold of the future, you have to make investment in the younger generation. That much I fully agree. Earlier, I attended a mobile festival at City University. The students showcased their mobile apps that they invented. One of them showed the chiropractor app, which was highly regarded in overseas jurisdictions. And they can create the next legend, Twitter or Facebook or whatever. Mr. Cheung of the City University said that setting up of an IT bureau will allow the developments to go beyond Hong Kong and to make a link between with the business sector, and the whole community can harness the potential of IT. Unfortunately, we don't have the bureau responsible for the development of IT. We have wasted our pool of talents. These students are studying mobile apps. They have all the ideas. But what is the next step? I feel distressed. Why? Mystified of why the pan-democrats are filibustering. I'm mystified as to why they are impeding the creation of the IT bureau. Not only are they wasting public money, they are wasting time, they are wasting the opportunities of a promising generation of young people. They're stopping them moving up the social ladder. People don't have any confidence about the IT bureau being created, and people are desperate about the situation. I did say that my granddaughter is 6 months old. I haven't seen her for a number of months. My daughter and daughter-in-law would like to have some startups, but given the situation in Hong Kong a fortnight ago, they went to San Francisco with my granddaughter.
In San Francisco, 365 days in a year, they hold a convention to talk about different kinds of innovation. Capital is adequate. People from all over the world go there to look for opportunities. So I talked to them. Soon we're going to get the Innovation and Technology Bureau. Then they said that, don't you think that we haven't watched their broadcast meeting on the TV screen? Meetings and meetings have been held, and you don't know that we are aware of it. I am speechless. I was speechless. Now, Charles Moore also said that we had to catch up the 12-year vacuum or the 12-year gap. And it takes us to the question that the relationship between the legislature and the executive is worsening. Now, filibustering by the pan-democrats is getting more and more personal. We have to think about this. Well, in fact, many people privately would think that the idea of an ITB is good. Why have we allowed ourselves to degenerate into this stage? Well, I think we shouldn't be stubborn in vetoing everything just because not happy with the CE. Now, we have only got a couple of new initiatives, and then we haven't got much commitment for education. We haven't got enough graduate teacher posts. English proficiency hasn't been given due weight. We haven't got anything for vocational education. And nothing is done to address the pressure faced by the students. I hope the officials will not be complacent. I recall that the CE had this electoral platform. He said that he would like to enhance the English language proficiency of our community. In this year's policy address, I could not even find the word English throughout, nor English language. I would think that at least we should be told about the progress as a gesture, as a token, but I don't get anything at all. We're supposed to have the mainland as our backup. We're supposed to face the global world. We're supposed to compete with other Asian countries. So what about our language proficiency levels? Poor English standards would affect our image as an international city. Now, Mind Your Head has been changed to beware of your head. It means that you have to beware that your head may be endangered. That's the sort of English we get on our signage. Young people are afraid of having to speak in English. And then for P6 students, I think there has only been an increase of 2% in relation to reaching the required standards in English. I think for our international English test for 10 years, we've only attained an improvement of 0.2 marks. That's for university graduates. I used to be the chair of Scholar. Now, we want to improve our English standards. We don't have the environment. Therefore, at a young age, we should encourage people to develop a greater interest in English language rather than just forcing them to speak in English. We need native English teachers. We're supposed to have one per school, but I don't think they can be effective in their teaching. The net teachers have said that if only they have got two per school, then the entire effort will be much more productive, and it will only cost $400 million more. But then when I put a question to the secretary, he said that he didn't find any problems with our English standards. And he said that whenever experts came, experts would tell us that one net teacher per primary school is fine, so there's no justification for doing anything more. I told him that consultants would not be objective in writing their reports. The secretary himself may be happy with the situation, but how do we compare with Singapore and other places? The secretary would not give a reply to my question. Now, poverty. Poverty is close to the heart of CY Leung. I have to declare interest. I'm a member of the Commission on Poverty. In year 2013, for the first time ever, the poverty line was set up. I think it is courageous. Now, we have identified those who are in need in our society. It means that it has to be followed by policy formulation. A clever administration would not just hand out all the surplus in our public coffers. Rather, we should consider making good use of the limited resources so that those who are in need will get a fair share. Now, for the policy address for retirement protection, we have got $50 billion being earmarked. If you want me to praise the policy address, then as the CS is the chairperson of the Commission on Poverty, then I have to single this out. Now, the society has a lot of requests for universal protection. Now, the government has stood firm and hasn't buckled under pressure. If you have read the report of the consultancy team under the leadership of Nelson Chow, Professor Nelson Chow, we have a chapter on elderly in poverty. Well, I think universal retirement protection will not talk about sustainability and affordability. So it is not realistic as an idea. Now, when it comes to collecting revenue, there isn't much disagreement. But when it comes to handing out money, then I don't think everybody would agree that every elderly person should be given a benefit. Would anybody agree that myself and you, Chair, President, should be given a benefit? I myself would not be willing to get any pension from the government. Now, for our party, our position is very clear. Now, Mr. Leung Che-cheung has told us about the DAP's position, and we are sharing the same view. We would like to have a three-tier system. Other than the OAA and the old age living allowance, there should be another tier. It should be means tested, and then anybody eligible will get $3,600 per month. As a member of the Commission on Poverty, I can see that this administration is sincere in helping the poor. I hope that you can think twice and act wise to make sure that public money will be spent wisely. Mr. President, I would like to talk about one of the problems in our governance. Now, it appears to me that the policy bureaus are taking care of their own portfolios only, without any coordination. When CY Leung would like to look for land to build houses, everybody will say, good. And then Paul Chen would like to build an artificial island in the central waters. He won't care about transport. He would only say that it will be connected. But what is the link? A ferry service or what? It appears that he will simply tell us that it will, the artificial island will be connected with the Hong Kong island. And therefore, he's been challenged by the lawmakers. How much would it cost? And what is the cost benefit, etc.? At the same time, STH Professor Zhang knows full well that the West Rail is already having its capacity exhausted. Now, with the SCL in place, it means that there will be a spare capacity of 10%. And then it will be extended to Tuen Mun Pier, Ferry Pier, and then Hong Shui Kiu, new development area will be developed. There will be more people going to NT East because of the Northern Loop. So the 10% spare capacity will soon be used up. By about 2025, the rail system will be saturated. Now, when are we going to get our next harbour crossing? Then I have said that Professor Zhang should consider having one from Tuen Mun to Lantau, and then the artificial island and the Hong Kong island. He said that the idea could not be proposed because we didn't have other details. Then I told him to have a word with Mr. Paul Chen. One has got an island but no rail link, while the other would like to have a rail link but doesn't know where to put it and where he can find the money to build the rail link. So I got the two together and I've told them, with the artificial island, it means that you can count on the revenue from development and give the money to MTRCL, and then perhaps the government doesn't have to spend a cent, and then we have a rail link connecting with Tuen Mun. Now, if we can do this, it means that there is coordination, there's synergy. When two policy bureaus are working together, then for those who are opposing the artificial island, we'll see 9 votes less, at least those from the new territory's constituency would not object to the idea. It appears that the idea has gone all the way up to the CE's years, and then we are told that there will be transport link between Island West and Anti-West. I'm just an elected member. Should I be expected to do so much on behalf of the public officers? Now, let me say a word from the bottom of my heart. Now, the Development Bureau is under the FS, while the THB is under another secretary. I don't know how much they have coordinated, to what extent they have coordinated the work. Perhaps you should think about the sort of structure of the government secretariat. Mr. President, I think more or less I have, but let me check. Lastly, I want to turn to the following point, and again, it is related to traffic and transport. Now, currently, we have a policy to give priority to the railway. Many people would support this idea, but we know that we can't allow the MTR to be dominant. We need to give different choices to the commuters, and then we need ground-level transport as well. When the MTR system has broken down, and if it remains so for 3 or 4 hours, then we need the road traffic to divert the commuting crowds. But we haven't got any report to review the road transport. Recently, the Transport Advisory Committee has come up with certain ideas to impose a penalty, but I don't think it is going to improve the to solve the problem. There are suggestions to increase the vehicle registration tax. Well, Hong Kong is a free society. Why should I be penalized to buy when I buy a car so that I'm discouraged from owning a car? There are weekend drivers. They don't drive their car when they go to work. They only want to drive during weekends to go around the city. So it is not a crime to own a private car. It's a matter of the usage pattern. In the past 10 years, the average speed of vehicles on our road in the 10 years ago, it was 25.6 kilometers per hour. Now, 10 years later, 22.7 km per hour. So we are 3 km slower. Now, in 70 years' time, it means that the road traffic in Hong Kong would be such that all the buses and vehicles would come to a standstill.
In overseas countries, in the past 5 years, the vehicular speed was enhancing. For public transport, like buses and minibuses, they should enjoy high priority on our roads. And this is the case throughout the whole world. Therefore, during rush hours, the government must consider electronic road pricing. You cannot escape that, be it electronic road pricing or roadside parking meters. Sooner or later, you must have courage to do that. Otherwise, during rush hours, all private cars will enter the busy zones and our traffic will come to a standstill. So, you must have courage. Vehicle speed is decreasing and decreasing, and buses take longer to reach their destinations. Society is changing. Therefore, Mr. President, I hope that the SARG can review those policies that met with resistance in the past. Should we not review them? the government should seriously resolve problems that are long-standing and are deteriorating. Mr. Frankie Yik, Mr. President, the CE said that he has reserved $50 billion to protect the livelihood of retirees. Now, if these are not empty words, the Liberal Party won't object to it. The Liberal Party understands that retirement protection is a very important social issue. However, any option must have fiscal sustainability. We must make good use of social resources to help those who are most in need. Society is divided on retirement protection, so the LP wants the government to enhance the existing retirement protection measures as well as the MPF first. These are the existing pillars. We're pleased that for elderly services, SEN students, support for PWDs and so forth, a number of initiatives have been announced. However, we should have long-term planning, and in accordance with existing statistics, we should make projection for the future and to assess our capacity in the future to plan for land, manpower, etc. Earlier, the Elderly Commission said that it will take into account demographic figures, health conditions, projected lifespan, living conditions, participation in the labor market, and financial ability. Well, this is something better late than never. So we must have short-term, medium, long-term measures for elderly services. We have to make sure that we have long-term planning to make sure that residential elderly services can meet social needs. But every time when it comes to elderly services, we ask where the money comes. Every time the government resorts to the excuse of financial difficulty to refrain from formulating long-term plans, or the government just want to dip into the pocket of the taxpayers. In fact, the public coffers are flooded with money. So what we need is dedication and commitment. So the LP wants the government to make use of the 3 trillion exchange fund reserve. $795 million of return was the latest figure. In the past 5 years, the average return rate was 2.6%. Part of the return from the exchange fund can be channeled to welfare services to benefit more needy persons. Finally, I'd like to emphasize that the LP considers that we should pool our resources to assist those who are in need. We shouldn't allow abuses, though we must plug the welfare loopholes. For example, we have to study for the able-bodied person's unemployment subsidy a certain duration and to target the well-off tenants under our housing policy. Mr. Chen Kimpo, thank you, Mr. President. The healthcare insurance scheme is now under consultation, and soon the consultation period will end. We have to consider sustainability. In the past 3 years, we talked with the Health and Welfare Bureau, and now we would like to have a perfected scheme. For example, we should have better insurance policies to provide better protection for the insured. So basically, we support the proposals. There are 2 issues to resolve. The Food and Health Bureau did not honor his promise in the past term, and the $50 billion were not mobilized. As for first-time deduction and deduction for long-term insurance policies, they are not forthcoming, and that has deterred people, I mean the insured. As regards the 12 major initiatives, we believe that they will be reflected on the premium. On the average, the premium will be $3,600 per year on the 2012 money terms. Soonest, we'll get it in 2017, but as medical expenses are ever rising at a rate higher than the inflation rate, premium will rise from year to year. Therefore, the premium will exceed the assessment in 2012. And the older the person, the higher the premium will be. For the age bracket of 40 to 49, premium with $4,750 for 6% increase for renewal. It will become $6,350. Given the 45% deviation mentioned by the consultant, the premium will jump to over $9,000. And according to the consultants, it will jump to $6,500 and then $9,000 and eventually increase to over $10,000. So if there are not sufficient financial incentives by providing first-time deduction and long-term deduction, you cannot attract healthy young people. You have to share risks and attract more young people to join the scheme in order to share out the risk such that the scheme can be sustainable. If only high-risk persons join the scheme won't be sustainable. Another unresolved problem is that the industry can only sell products that satisfy the minimum requirements. As a result, low-premium, low-price products can't be sold in the market. I hope that we can understand that the Bureau is actually using its invisible hand to intervene with the market, such that members of the public cannot, in accordance with their own financial ability, make a choice. It is emphasized that to protect the public, products must satisfy those 12 minimum requirements, but the government is paving the road to hell with good intentions. The issue is complicated. For the low-price insurance policies, they're badly in need in the market. Well, such low-price policies cannot provide sufficient protection. But why is it that so many people pursue them? Some of these insured took out the insurance years ago, but the protection, the coverage is not enough, so they take on another policy to enhance the protection. And that's why some people hold more than one policy. Another situation is that the employer has taken out insurance for the employee who deems that not enough, so the employee will take out another policy. And some chronically ill can only take out low price policy to cover diseases not covered. Fourthly, some people don't think they will fall ill very easily, and they're not financially capable for high-priced policies, so they take out low-priced policies. So there is a demand for low-priced policies. If you don't allow them, then these people will only go back to public hospitals. Well, there may be hundreds of thousands of these people. So the ultimate medical and healthcare cost will be much higher. And without low-price policies, these small and medium insurance companies can compete with large companies, which will then monopolize the market. I don't think you want to see that happen. The insurance sector discussed this issue for many years, and many problems have been solved. We are just a step from success. So please consider our opinion. First of all, the $50 billion reserved for first-time deduction and long-term deduction such that young people are willing to take out a policy. Then the scheme can be sustainable. Secondly, to abolish the mandatory requirement that insurance companies can only offer products that satisfy the 12 minimum requirements. To protect the consumers, the insurer can be required to disclose the difference in protection between low-priced policies and normal policies. That's another option. That is, the industry will use the 12 minimum requirements as a blueprint. Apart from, say, two of the requirements that cannot be sustainable, for the remaining, the industry can satisfy the requirements within the time frame and be put under the regulation of the IAA. Then members of the public will get most of the merits without having to pay a high premium. So it's worthwhile for the government to consider that. I hope that the Bureau will keep an open mind to discuss with the industry, and please have collective wisdom so that we can have enhanced healthcare insurance product with a higher transparency to protect the consumers. Mr. Chen Hanpeng will speak on medical issues. We're now suffering from an imbalance. Just see the flu epidemic. For many weeks, all our hospitals are full. And some wards have to lend, so to speak, beds to the medical ward. So the problem of imbalance is really serious. Well, hospitals might have launched special measures to encourage healthcare personnel to work overtime or to encourage medical and healthcare students to practice in hospitals. Here, I'd like to thank all the medical and healthcare personnel for keeping to their own posts in this under this very huge pressure. And these days, I believe the secretary is also very busy, so he should also take care of himself. Well, these medical and healthcare issues may not be solved in the short term, but we have to do something pragmatic. Well, we should have a hospital for the chronic diseases, and there should be public-private partnership for outpatient clinics, and Kwong Wah Hospital, etc., will be redeveloped. We see that in future, we'll have so many projects in our public hospitals, manpower remains our major concern or worry. And just now, Mr. Chan Kim Paul said that we'll have a voluntary healthcare insurance regime. Well, a number of patients may go to the private sector, so doctors in the public sector may practice in the private sector, and our public hospitals will only become a training base, and patients in the public sector may just be guinea pigs. So, for manpower planning, we hope that the hospital authority can pay special attention to the so-called weaker clusters of hospitals, like that in New Territories West. I know a doctor who told me that Tumon Hospital lacks resources and the image of the hospital is not good, so every day he has to travel far to go to another cluster to work. So I hope that the HA can assist the so-called disadvantaged or weaker clusters and to address this manpower imbalance issue. I'd also like to talk about Chinese medicine and Chinese medicine practitioners. Last year, the CE said that Hong Kong will get a Chinese medicine hospital. Well, the industry was so happy. They've been waiting for so long. Well, irrespective of whether the hospital will really come true, at least they have a plan.
And this year, the policy address and talks about this Chinese medicine. There is going to be a HKCMMS, Hong Kong Chinese Materia Medica Standards. What are these all about? Nobody knows much about it. Now, for this HKCMMS, it is there to conduct certification and study on the Chinese herbs and so on. Now, for Chinese herbs and the study of Chinese herbs will have academic value. It doesn't have much in the way of practical value because we're not manufacturing center. So what good does this do with regard to the HKCMMS? If you go to a herbal shop, herbal store, you're buying some processed Chinese herbal medicine. The HKCMMS is about the raw materials, so you may have not have the foggiest idea, like sao wu, it may be toxic when it is raw. It has to be processed. It has to be processed with certain materials to get rid of the toxic properties. HKCMMS is about the study of the properties of the herbal medicine. It may not help a great deal with the herbs that we're using. We're not studying the utilization, rather we are studying the raw materials. So what good does it do? For the trade, they're not really asking for this. China has some far more sophisticated medica, and the Chinese medicine trade is following this material medica from China. The HKCMMS is pitched at a very high standard, and the practitioners are saying that the government is doing something that is not particularly practical. But as I said, this is of academic value. What are the problems facing the Chinese medicine? I think the key thing is to assist them in transformation, amend the legislation and face the reality. When Hong Kong wanted to become a Chinese medicine port, we pitched the standard at a very high level. Now we may be far higher than the standard in the mainland of China. Now we have 8,000 or so different Chinese herbs, and they cannot be registered despite all these years. And like Yungatlam, the trouble is it cannot be registered because it doesn't measure up to the very, very high standard set by the government. But this is a kind of intangible heritage of the nation. I think it is our system that is making it difficult to register these Chinese herbs. And it is wholly absurd. The government has to face the reality. Many manufacturers are small-time businesses, and it is difficult for them to follow the stringent requirement. The government requires them to invest in GMP and all these testing work. There is not a big market for this, that the medicine cannot enter into the mainland of China. So I think we have to create the same market between Hong Kong and China. The government wants the pharmaceutical manufacturers to do well, but you cannot make them follow if they are not able to. The first thing the DAP would like to propose is to set up a fund for the Chinese medicine to undergo transformation. Second, we have to be integrated with the mainland in terms of Chinese traditional Chinese medicine. I think you ought to listen to what we have to say. I have very little time left. I'd just like to say that the Chinese medical practitioners would like to have a representative here in this council, and they like to have a seat here, and this is something that should be considered. The development of traditional Chinese medicine, we have a pretty good foundation. The mainland government has entered into agreement with the Macau government over many issues, and I don't think we should be overtaken by Macau because of all these bureaucracy. Mr. Vincent Fang, President, in the policy address last year, the government said that the quality of the public sector medical care will be improved, that there will be more new hospitals and existing hospitals that will be undergoing redevelopment. And the Liberal Party welcomed that. Now, we put a critical question with the existence of hardware. What are you going to do with the software? In terms of doctors and allied professionals, there is a severe shortfall in Hong Kong. Professor Joseph Lee subscribes to this idea. The Liberal Party, together with the Democratic Party, put forward a proposal regarding the shortage of doctors. We presented that to the hospital authority, the MDAC, and also the FHB. And they agree with our proposals. But regarding importation of doctors, they have to refer these to the medical council. We wrote to the medical council for a meeting to be set up as of today, 9 months on. We haven't heard from the medical council at all. In the policy address this year, our proposals were responded to slightly. We are happy about it. It shows that the chief executive does have the commitment to make improvement to livelihood, but rather the medical Hong Kong Medical Council, which is an independent professional body, can't be bothered to respond to us. Each year, at the height of the flu epidemic, we can appreciate the demand for health care, like the 164 have already died of the flu. 90% of them are senior citizens or chronically ill. We have a huge demand for healthcare services, and people are living ever longer these days, and the pressure on the healthcare is increasing by the day. In the policy address, there will be more care shown for the senior citizens, and in the next triennium, the government will support will create more places, degree places for dentistry and medical doctors. The Liberal Party welcomes this. So in terms of livelihood, we award 60 points to the chief executive. But this will not happen until 2029. Or 2025, I mean, in the interim period, do we have to be kept waiting for 8 to 10 hours in the A&E departments? The imported doctors can only work in designated fields or in the academic institutions. They will not affect the mass market. And the number can be adjusted when the number of doctors is sufficient. We can reduce the recruitment. It is very, very flexible. In fact, the whole world is moving in this direction. Medical tourism and also beauty therapy, Singapore, Taiwan, Japan, in Korea, they are developing in these areas, and they many members have been talking about high-end visitors. Because of the anachronistic legislation, it is difficult to develop medical carers in the industry. We have Dr. Ko here, and you are very ambitious. You propose the review of the regulation of private sector hospital care. We welcome these kind of regulation, because it's only with a sound legislation that we can foster healthy development of the sector. And I hope that there would be more views from the sector.
I cannot see how we cannot have it becoming an industry. Now I want to talk about food safety. Well, we have been told that it is very likely that if you come into contact with a sick chicken, then you will get in bird flu. But I don't think this is right. Among the many cases of bird flu, I want to know about the percentage of the patients catching the disease as a result of contact with the animals, with the poultry. I think only 5 or 6 died as a result of avian flu. The secretary has said that a consultant will be asked to look into the matter. I think it's better for you to sort of save the money. In fact, I already told you that the idea won't work when we first looked at the question of having new arrangements for the sale of live poultry. Well, just now, a member said that we should ban the importation of live chicken. And in fact, recently, we have got the voice heard again, that is, we should be self-sufficient in terms of the supply and demand of poultry. I think it's impossible for us to go back to the old days. Well, in fact, I think we have globalization, and in fact, we need to have something which is up to international standards so as to test our food, so as to have safeguards, so that we have something that cater for the needs of Hong Kong.
越來越出位就越多傳媒報導.
I hope we will not lose our rationality just because some speech which went out of its way. We should not try to copy the UK and the US, otherwise we have to send someone to the space to procure our supplies. Does any other member wish to speak? If not, I will ask the three officials to speak. Mr. Ronnie Tong.
主席，我想讲讲关于
Mr. Deputy, I would like to talk about poverty alleviation. My speech in this session and the one in the next session on population policy are related, but since no one raised their hands, I thought I might as well say something now. Mr. Deputy, my concerns have a common theme, and that is the nurturing of our youth. Mr. Deputy, poverty alleviation hinges on one important thing, and that is we want to prevent intergeneration poverty. We want to make sure that our society is mobile. This is not rocket science, it's just basic common sense. Mr. Deputy, for those of us who grew up in the 50s and 60s, we have a similar experience. I think the CS experienced this, so did you, Mr. Deputy, so did Mr. C.Y. Leung. For those of us who grew up in families with limited means, and today we have achieved some career advancement to different degrees, but today's young people are not as fortunate as we. There are signs of downward social mobility. They started to appear in the Donald Zhang's era, so we cannot just blame C.Y. Leung for this. But since you have inherited this unfortunate legacy, something unfortunate for Hong Kong, in terms of a social phenomena, is unfortunate. So the current administration has the duty to do something to improve the situation. I don't think C.Y. Leung is unaware of this. Well, he is learned and he is clever. So when it comes to the measures undertaken to alleviate poverty, I'm sure
he knows about what measures can be done. Last night, I dug out this book from my drawer, bottom of my drawer, the C election, my manifesto. He wants to do things the right way. I didn't have a chance to ask him what it was about. But when it comes to poverty alleviation, we should support our young people, to use the government's language. Well, you should teach young people how to fish. That's the real poverty alleviation measure, and it's effective. If I may, I would like to read out a few points in this C election manifesto. Let's refresh our memory on what C.Y. Leung said when he ran for the office of a CE. And in paragraph 4, he said, for those who are over 15, those who have received a tertiary education, it's just 23.8%, which is on the low side, which is not conducive to the transformation of Hong Kong into a knowledge-based economy, and it has also caused a mismatch in the job market. That's how he described the situation Hong Kong people face, and how we could address the problem. And if we turn to the pages on education, objective, the government has a duty to provide fair opportunity for education. No student should be prevented from furthering his studies because of lack of means, and there should be strengthening measures to help the poor. And education is investment, not expenditure. Well, that's very high sounding. Yeah, education is investment. But after C.Y. Leung has taken office, how much is invested? How much has been invested in education? In the second paragraph, tertiary education, he said in paragraph 16, we should explore more channels for the secondary school leavers to advance their studies, that there should be more degree places, and there should be private university places offered. Paragraph 19. He said he would allow graduates to repay their loans more flexibly, and he would restart the matching grant scheme to encourage the community to support university education. He would look into the possibility of establishing private universities in Hong Kong so that Hong Kong can become an education hub. Nothing has been achieved, Mr. Deputy. Nothing here has been achieved. It's already the third year of Mr. C.Y. Leung's administration. All these stated in the manifesto have been abandoned. In this year's policy address, let's flip through the policy address. Has anything been said about poverty alleviation or help for our young people so that they know how to fish? Or to help them to get tertiary education? I flipped through this policy address. I can't even find one paragraph on these issues. And on youth education and development, with what one paragraph? 158. Or 150, it said that some tertiary educations have accumulated big surpluses. These community college of UGC funded institutions have accumulated large surpluses, we would ask the institutions to critically review their financial position and consider ways to use the surpluses to benefit their students, such as lowering tuition fees or offering scholarship or bursary for underprivileged students. This is the only paragraph in the policy address on education of our young people. And from what I've read, you know that he has shirked all his responsibilities. He's telling the tertiary institutions that you have a lot of money, you should do something, not me. I've just read out from his manifesto. Didn't he say encouragement should be given to the establishment of private universities? Didn't he say that there should be more subvented university places? But how many university places have been added since he took office? I've heard a news report 2 weeks ago. It's not been substantiated so far. It was said that the SAR government would cut subsidies for students from outside Hong Kong. Well, I was moved somewhat by the news. Now Mr. Leung is listening to his conscience. He would devote the resources saved to help the underprivileged children. But there's nothing to follow up in this policy address. Nothing. From cover to cover, you find nothing. He's not saying that I'm going to do it next year or that last year I did enough already. He's not going to do it. He's saying that the community college of tertiary institutions have large surpluses. In this council, I've mentioned time and again that in order to help underprivileged children, we should increase the number of subsidized university places. We speak of this need every year, but the government has ignored us. We can look at the figures for the past few years. For non-local students, in 2009-10, 10,300, 2010-2011, 17,900, 1112, 20,900, 1213, 26,600. The increase is so big. Doesn't it mean that opportunities for local students will be diminished? Because overall, we are not increasing the number of university places. I'm not trying to get rid of overseas students.
In terms of resource allocation, just following the words of C.Y. Leung, we had to invest in our young people. Why doesn't he do it? If we are to invest in our young people, then I would like to see our students, in particular students with lack of means, will have a higher and higher chance of receiving university education. In particular, they should be given financial subvention. Now, after reading the policy address, what in fact did the CE say? He says that young people should go back to the mainland, more cooperation, more exchanges, linked up with mainland schools as sister schools. Is he prescribing the right medicine? I don't understand why the CE feels that going to the mainland, having exchanges with mainland students, are more important than giving more tertiary education to our young people. I'm not saying that exchange is not important, but he is so keen on, say, helping young people, why doesn't he honor his words and do something more for our young people, young students in particular? I will now invite the three officials to speak. Each of them will speak may speak for 15 minutes, and they may speak up to a total of 45 minutes. The Secretary for the Administration. Now, this covers poverty, welfare, public health, and environmental hygiene. I thank members for spoken, and nine have spoken on retirement protection. As the chairman on commission steering committee or commission on poverty, I will respond on poverty issue and retirement protection. Secretary for labor and welfare, food and health, secretary will speak according to their portfolios.
Poverty alleviation is the priority of this term of government. We have been rolling out measures for the past 2.5 years. For example, starting from January 2013, we've enhanced the work incentive travel subsidy, and we also implemented the old age living allowance in April the same year. This measure benefited over 420,000 elderly, with about $6 billion extra recurrent expenditure. With the help of the Commission on Poverty, the chief executive in 2014's policy address announced the poverty alleviation blueprint covering a number of measures for different needy groups. For example, the low-income family allowance is one of the major welfare measures after the OLA with public money of about $3 billion a year involved. Another major social welfare policy in this term of government shows the determination and commitment on the government, on the part of the government on poverty. Now, Mr. Christopher Jung and Mr. Michael Tian acknowledged the effort of this government in poverty alleviation. Even Mr. Peter Jung, representing the social welfare sector, described the policy address 2015's welfare-related initiatives as mediocre and ordinary. And Mr. Ronnie Tong just now mentioned that as far as poverty alleviation is concerned, the focus should be on grooming our next generation to provide more opportunities for upward mobility to realize the objective of poverty alleviation. I support this argument, but I think Mr. Ronnie Tong is quite forgetful. Just now, you mentioned a number of measures to help our young people, and in fact, these measures were put forward in last year's policy address. And in fact, there was a chapter in the policy address 2014 on youth development, covering education, employment, etc. And we are implementing these measures one by one. And they include counseling services on employment and further studies to provide more opportunities for tertiary education. For example, we have 2,000 extra subsidized university places and also extra assistance or subsidy for needy students. In the policy address 2015, for the initiatives mentioned by Mr. Ronnie Tong, they are just working on the basis formed in policy address 2014, and Mr. Ronnie Tong perhaps should refer to last year's policy address and the policy agenda of this year in this regard. But in our next session, we will debate further the relevant initiatives. Now, apart from youth development, we attach importance to empirical evidence. We formed the poverty line, and we also analyzed year by year the poverty situation in Hong Kong so that we could objectively assess the result of our work. In 2013, the poverty in Hong Kong, the situation improved comparing to 2012 quite significantly. The
the population living in poverty in Hong Kong dropped from 1.02 million in 2012 to 0.97 million in 2013, and the poverty ratio decreased from 15.7% to 14.5%. As for elderly people living in poverty, the rate dropped from 44.9% in 2013 before policy intervention to 30.5% after policy intervention by about 14.4%, much higher than the drop of 1.2% in 2012 before policy intervention. The main cause is the implementation of the OALA, which benefited 420,000 needy elderly people. And according to the poverty line analysis in 2013, for non-CSSA working households, they are not benefited from the regular welfare measures, and they account for about 140 households in Hong Kong. And last year, the policy address introduced the low-income family working family allowance for the purpose of helping these families. As the funding application was approved half a year later than expected, that is in January this year, the Labour and Welfare Bureau is working full steam to prepare for its launch, which is expected to be launched in 1.5 years' time. This will benefit 200,000 low-income families or 710,000 people, including 170,000 children and students. Apart from these policy measures, the CCF is also an important area of poverty alleviation. Since establishment in 2011, the CCF has already introduced 27 programs benefiting 870,000 people. The CCF has played its function as plugging the gaps of government policies. And the 10 CCF projects have been regularized, involving around 800 million annual recurrent expenditure. We'll continue to regularize other measures that have proven result. In June 2013, with government injection of $15 billion, we have more resources to roll out more assistance programs and pilot schemes to help those with financial difficulties. And we will also continue with those effective programs that have yet to be included or regularized so that we can continue to provide support for the needy. This year, in 2014, the CCF introduced 4 new programs. In the beginning of this year, we have introduced the one-off living subsidy for low-income households not living in public housing and not receiving CSSA. And the CCF will, in due course, expand the coverage of elderly dental assistance programs to benefit more elderly people. And based on the CE's recommendation in the policy address, the CCF will, in due course, start to study a number of new items, including expanding the school textbook assistance scheme. And 9 members talked about retirement protection, and I'd like to respond to that. Retirement protection is an important and complex issue. It involves people's livelihood, social welfare, economic development, and public finance. And this is very controversial, and a discussion on retirement protection could be politicized. And personally, it is a struggle between sense and sensibility. A couple of days ago, I attended an FTU gathering for elderly people, and during the gathering, I was asked to introduce some kind of protection that is non-means tested so that they get adequate protection after retirement. Well, I was quite moved by the elderly's suggestion, but in terms of public finance, it is the responsibility of the government to allocate resources in a reasonable manner. Well, on retirement protection, it has been discussed in the community for many years, and so far we haven't been able to forge consensus, and yet this administration has not dodged the issue. The chief executive in his election manifesto suggested the studying into short, medium, and long-term measures to improve the existing social welfare and retirement protection system. The Commission on Poverty commissioned Professor Nelson Chow in May 2013 to lead a team to conduct a study, and the report of the study was submitted to the COP in last August, and now it's been fully disclosed for public access. After the release of Professor Chow's report, there have been extensive discussions in the community with divergent views. There are some views that suggest that retirement protection is a basic right of elderly people and not welfare. And there are also other suggestions on using the resources on needy elderly people, and there should not be any, and they're against non-means tested proposals. And there are also other questions on who should pay the bill and the impact on public finance, the sustainability of the proposal, feasibility, so on and so forth. So it's not as some members say that there is unanimous support for universal retirement protection. In fact, even in today's discussion, we have heard divergent views. And I'd like to elaborate on a number of points raised on the retirement protection in the policy address. First of all, we believe that study into retirement protection is for the purpose of providing better life protection for needy elderly people. This should be the purpose. In earlier on, I already mentioned that according to the analysis of the poverty line in 2013, announced at the end of last year, although the situation has significantly improved, but there are still 285,000 elderly people living below the poverty line, and this government should should give them better life protection and welfare. And secondly, when exploring this complex issue, we need to explain that the philosophy of welfare policies is to encourage the able-bodied and the young to be self-reliant, whereas the government should provide social protection and welfare to those who cannot sustain on their own. And also, according to the report released by the Financial Secretary last year, due to aging population, even if we don't improve on our existing welfare and healthcare services, with aging population and inflation, we're going to experience structural deficit a decade later. So we have to prepare for additional financial commitment for retirement protection and social protection for elderly people. And we might need to gather funds, and we must understand all the impacts, including the feasibility, sustainability, and the commitment of the program and of the plan and the long-term impact on Hong Kong's development. Thirdly, we should forge a consensus and find the way forward on the basis of a pragmatic, rational, and comprehensive discussion. There are views that the government, before the public consultation, already formed a preconceived stance to veto the universal retirement proposal. I want to point out that the COP is still discussing the discussing how the consultation should be done, and some members agree that this issue has been discussed in the community for many years, and Professor Chow's report has also provided basis for discussion. So specific proposals should be mentioned in the consultation document, including whether the proposal should be universal or non-universal retirement protection for public discussion. And as the policy address points out, the Financial Secretary has already reserved $50 billion as financial commitment on the proposal that will be subject to public consultation. Mr. Tan Kapil asked why the public consultation won't be carried out until the fourth quarter of this year. As in the middle of this year, the government's CNSD will be announcing or releasing the latest population and workforce population projection. And members all agreed to extend the projection period to 50 years. And there will be a working group set out for this purpose, and the COP anticipate that the public consultation should be kickstarted in the fourth quarter of this year for the purpose of giving time for the preparation of a consultation document. As this issue is complex, we oppose at this stage any commitment by the government to roll out universal retirement protection before public consultation.
Secretary for Labour and Welfare, I thank the members who have spoken in this session. I will be responding in respect of elderly care and welfare services. This term of government attaches importance to elderly poverty alleviation, elderly care, and support for the disadvantaged. We set policies which are positive to provide better and more focused services to the needy and to foster the building of a harmonious society. To promote active aging, we will provide more support to elderly, elder academy in terms of finance, programming, and trainee training and networking in the districts so that it can sustain its development. We are also going to provide better support for physically disabled elderly, the $2 fare concession to the green minibus. We expect that in the first phase, 380 routes or the 78% of the total will be covered. 2 or 3 months after that, we are going to launch the second phase of the concession scheme. For support of physically frail elders, we would implement the policy on aging in place as a core, institutional care as backup. We'll continue to invest and provide more places and enhance existing services. In 2014-15, additionally, we're going to provide 230 daycare places. Starting from next month, there will be 1,500 improved home and community care quota to be introduced. As for subsidized places, we are going to increase 1,580 places starting from 2014 all the way to 2016-17. The elderly commission is also looking into the possibility of a service voucher for the residential care. In the middle of this year, they're going to submit a report. We are going to invest $800 million so as to introduce 3,000 service vouchers and to provide additionally 5,000 subsidized places. To face the rapid aging populations, the Commission will also be planning on working out the Elderly Services Program Plan. In the middle of 2016, they will support a report. We are going to step up our support for the disabled. Next year, we are going to launch a pilot scheme and invite rehab organizations and NGOs so that they can offer outreach rehab services to kindergartens and kindergartens come nurseries. There will be more social workers to serve the parents and their family and the family members of the disabled. On mental health, we have been investing heavily. So far, every year we have invested $250 million. In 2015 and 16, we are going to increase the social workers in the mental wellness centers to step up community support, and also their family support for the family member will be enhanced. And we are also going to explore the idea of a pilot scheme to introduce a peer supporters scheme involving the mentally ill. For those who are suffering from autism, we are going to launch another pilot scheme to provide training and support for parents and carers of autistic patients. And we're also going to provide professional training to organizations serving these autistic persons. We understand that because of the aging population, we need to provide more support for rehabilitation services. We have increased the recurrent expenditure by $160 million in the past 2 years so that we can provide better service for older service users. And there will also be enhancement to the allied professionals'
serving the RCHEs and also other service recipients. The funding approval has been granted for the low-income working family allowance, and we are working on the preparation so that in the after 15 or 18 months, we can launch the scheme fully. In the meantime, we are going to provide one-off express-year payment for those recipients of school textbooks subsidy scheme. In the long term and medium and long term planning, the LWB and the social welfare sector is working on the special scheme on privately owned sites for welfare users. There are 60 projects, and there are 5 that can be completed in 2017 and 18. We will provide 100 and 450 RCHE places and rehab places respectively, and also we are going to provide further support to the navigation scheme for young persons in care services so that additionally 1,000 young people can join the service sector. We have also adopted a new thinking to help young people. There will be 1,000 places to help young people who would become the who work in the elderly care and rehab services sector. We would begin to recruit trainees in the latter half this year. Many members have asked us to enhance services for the care of young children. We have launched a number of measures. We have also increased the quota for extended time hour service from 1,200 to 6,200, an increase of 4 times. In 2017 and 18, we are also going to provide additionally 100 subsidized extended hour service and full day daycare service places. And also through this special scheme on privately owned sites for elderly users, we would ask NGO to set up nurseries, and there are 2 NGOs which have responded positively, and they can provide 100 self-financing places. And we also look into ways to introduce pilot projects and set up some service units in the Chongguan-O. We're also going to start a consultancy study on the long-term development of services for young children. Dr. Hannah Wong has asked that all government departments that in setting major government policies, they reference should be made to the gender mainstreaming checklist. We attach importance to gender equality and the welfare of women. The administration is going to step up training on sensitivity towards gender mainstreaming. Mr. Christopher Cheung wants us to increase the coverage and cover Fujian instead of Guangdong. We cover Guangdong because of the cultural and historical background and the relationship between the two places. At this moment, we have no intention to extend the coverage to another province, but we would learn from the experience of the Guangdong scheme before we chart along the way forward. When the time is appropriate, we would look into the feasibility of extending the scheme to other provinces, including Fujian. The policy addressed this year clearly demonstrates that Hong Kong is determined and committed to providing suitable welfare to our people. I so submit, I urge members to support this year's policy address.
Secretary for Food and Health, I'd like to thank members for their views in respect of food safety and health care, both at this meeting and also at the meeting of the healthcare panel. I will speak on food safety and related areas. And then in the second part, I will speak on the health care part. The first part one, new agricultural policy. This term the government attaches importance to agricultural policy. We are now doing public consultation on new agricultural policy, That includes the setting up of Agriculture Sustainable Development Fund to help value-added activities and branding, and also we set up a farm, agricultural farm, or rather agricultural park. And two members have put emphasis on new agricultural policy and farm products. Our new policy is in response to the demand for quality farm products in Hong Kong. Mr. Stephen Ho referred to agricultural policy, but he said that we didn't mention development of fishery. I hope Mr. Ho also understand that development of fishery industry, in fact, the administration has been implementing the various recommendations of the Committee on Fishery Development. And we are also implementing, we have also set up a sustainable fishery fund. I hope Mr. Ho and the community will support the new agricultural policy and promote sustainable development of agriculture, and will consider the views and allocate resources to formulate plans and implement plans as for developing fisheries or the fishing industry, that the fishery loan fund, the FC proposed to, we applied to the FC to raise the loan fund and earmark $400 million for coastal trawlers to so as and the FC the progress of the because the progress of the FC and also the Lunar New Year, we proposed that we change the deadline, and we will we have withdrawn the application. You know that the trade wants the injection as soon as possible. We will resubmit our amended proposal to the FC very soon so that the application can be approved as early as possible. Several members expressed a concern towards the outbreak of avian flu and the supply chain for live chickens in Hong Kong. As usual, in dealing with avian flu, we will maintain our monitoring policy and reduce the risk of outbreak at the end of the by the end of the year, or at the end of the year, H7 N9 bacteria virus were found in Hong Kong, and therefore we suspended operation of the poultry wholesale market and affected and stopped the supply of live chickens from China. But on the 22nd of January, we reopened the Changsha Wan temporary wholesale poultry market, and the mainland has started the supply of live chickens to Hong Kong from the 10th of February onwards. And we hope that the mainland can ensure safety of the poultry supply to Hong Kong, and they will be able to resume the supply in full swing. Some members referred to the following. Ms. Wong and Mr. Chen said that, Mr. Chen said that our local chicken supply cannot be self-sufficient. Now, we have pointed out that even in advanced countries like European countries and East Asian countries, having introduced high level of protection towards high level of control towards preventing avian flu, they still have avian flu outbreaks. Now, we have a supply chain of live chickens. The trade and the administration have to work together to maintain the supply chain. We've noticed that when there is an outbreak of avian flu, or when there are positive samples found, there were shocks and losses were incurred by the trade. It seems that the community is not able to understand that we have to pay a price and also to face the shocks to maintain such a supply chain, and we have asked a consultant to study whether we should maintain the supply of live chickens. We have no preconceived decision. Now, the consultancy report is not purely because of the avian the risk of avian flu. In fact, our supply chain concerning our supply chain, we've already done our best to minimize the risk. Despite all that, because of the risk and also suspension of supply, are we prepared to accept all these and pay such a price? And because of this, we need to review the policy from time to time. As regulating infant and young children, small children food, we are now we're trying to regulate the formula milk for children under 36 months and also health claims. And we are now doing the public consultation. During the consultation period, apart from the trade, which have provided operational issues relating to their operation, the majority are supportive of the direction of control. We need to pay attention to epidemics. We also need to pay to non-epidemics. Illnesses may have a bigger, other non-epidemic illnesses may have threats to our community, and we are introducing measures to reduce the excessive intake of sugar and salt through food. We are doing a campaign on this, and we also extend our food examination and enhance the laboratory's capability so as to enhance food safety in Hong Kong. We are now consulting the districts, and I hope that the local people can understand that this scheme is very important to the overall health, overall food safety of our community, and it will give us support. Some members have paid attention to the safety of edible oil and the recovery of waste oil. Earlier on, we announced, we announced that in the first half of this year, with regard to the edible safety of edible oil and recovery or collection of waste oil, there will be a consultation and CFS will step up the testing of edible oil imported from other parts of the world. Ms. Helena Wong referred to the regulation of heavy metals. I'm glad that she paid attention to this. We've already stated that we will start our work to enhance the regulatory framework for heavy metal, heavy metals. As for columbarium policy, we'll continue to work with the cooperate with the council with regard to the study of the private columbarium bill. We want to introduce the law to strengthen regulation of private columbaria. We have started the 24 sites in 18 districts for constructing columbaria. We consulted the North District Council and Eastern District Council on Chai Wan, and North District columbarium there, columbaria, they were able to provide 225,000 niches. And we've consulted sites, two sites, one in Tuen Mun and one in North District. And if the two sites are completed, they can provide another 240,000 niches. If the four schemes can be completed, we'll be able to provide more than 400,000 niches. I hope the political parties and local groups will support our scheme so that other columbaria schemes or columbarium schemes can be endorsed by the district councils, and this council can also give the approval. And of course, we'll continue to encourage members of public to adopt more environment-friendly funeral practices. We've commissioned a consultant on enhancement of public markets, enhance their business environment, and study on the positioning of public markets. Recommendation, I will listen to the views of the panel, and then we will formulate our preliminary proposals and listen to the views of stakeholders and market stallholders. And we also know that some members of the council are concerned that concerned about these enhancement schemes, and we hope that we can improve the business environment of these small traders. We'll continue to work with the relevant committees and panels and implement their scheme. Step by step, let me now move to part two, public health. In terms of public health, we have a healthcare system with public healthcare as the core and supported by private healthcare sector. We do not agree with the amendment of Dr. K.K. Kwok. He alleged that the CE has not responded to people's call for improving or correcting our public health system. In fact, we have introduced suitable measures to enhance the overall quality and quantity of public healthcare system. In August 2013, we set up a review committee on HA, review comprehensively the operation of the HA. The steering committee had 8 meetings up till now. The structure of the HA has been reviewed, and we will study the recommendations, and then there will be a report. And we hope that you can see by then that we have fully addressed the issues raised by citizens and stakeholders, including frontline staff members, in respect of the operation of the HA and also the allocation resources.
在醫護的人力規劃方面呢,
as for manpower planning, we have conducted a strategic study on manpower, and we aim at completing our strategy in 2015 concerning a healthcare professional strategy. And we actively consider from 2016-17, 2017-18 to increase publicly funded first degree places for dentists and also medical doctors. And we have also worked with the Medical Council to introduce several measures to relax the recruitment of overseas doctors. That includes examination arrangements and also practical tests. We hope that this will be more effective and help us in enhancing our medical and healthcare and medical manpower. As enhancing healthcare services, apart from reviewing public sector healthcare service and doing manpower planning in 2015-16, we introduced a series of measures to enhance our healthcare services. That includes increase of hospital beds, increase in service sessions, increase in operational facilities. Operation facilities, I will not go into details. As for large-scale construction projects, in the first address, the CE has already announced that there will be a new acute hospital in Kai Tak, and there will also be expansion programs, including UCH, the Kwong Wah, and other hospitals, and the progress of other projects are going well. In the coming year, the HA will spend about $1 billion to support over 1,300 projects, small minor works projects, to enhance medical facilities and increase number of hospital beds. As for regulation of private hospitals, private healthcare sector, and voluntary healthcare insurance, in December we have already proposed, we have started the consultation on regulation of private healthcare service and also healthcare insurance. Mr. Chen Yinpo, on behalf of the insurance industry, has made a number of focused proposals as to how the trade can cooperate with the government and implement the voluntary health insurance scheme. We listen to the trade and will work with the trade with a view to implementing our scheme, our policy. Some members are concerned how we're going to spend the $50 billion. Now, concerning the voluntary health care insurance, it may not spend all the $50 billion. I want to stress that apart from this $50 billion scheme, there are other taxation concession and other measures to help us to implement voluntary health care insurance. Dr. Joseph Lee asks us to pay attention to primary health care. The government has, in fact, done several things, as for example, the metabolism illnesses of the among small children, and also colorectal cancer screening, we have introduced some pilot schemes, and we also attach importance to primary health care.
長者的醫療方面,我們是在牙科的服務。
As for dental service for the elderly, there is a proposal this year in which elderly who are age 80 or above who are eligible to ALA will be covered by the CCF, and the CCF will provide subvention for dental care for these elderly people. We are to implement the scheme with a limited scale because of the limited number of dentists. Our proposal of our proposal will cover 130,000 elderly people. We hope that after reaching this age group, we can extend the service to other age groups. As a Chinese medicine, Mr. Chen Henning Pan asked us to listen to the sector and care for their difficulties. In terms of development of Chinese medicine, we are formulating our Hong Kong standard and also setting up a testing center. Apart from the testing center scheme, we also will work with the HA and implement a pilot scheme in respect of the long-term development of Chinese medicine in hospital service. As for mental health, there is a steering committee working on it. The policy address has proposed some enhancements. Some members are concerned that we are just doing providing service, but we do not put enough emphasis on promoting mental health. The Department of Health will mount a territory-wide publicity campaign and work with NGOs and local groups to promote mental health. As for influenza, members have expressed concern about the rather serious peak of the influenza. Now we are strengthening our hospital service. We also step up communication and release of information by enhancing our transparency. The HA, as for the HA, now during the peak of the winter influenza, there is a package to deal with that, and there will be more than 200 hospital beds in 2014-15, another 200 or more than 200 hospital beds in 2015-16. During the peak season, there will be another 280 hospital beds for 6 months to deal with influenza. The hospital authority has redeployed its manpower to meet the influenza, the peak of the influenza period. And if pressure is too high, we may not rule out the possibility of delaying some non-emergency service in order to meet the rising demand to care for flu patients. As for the migration or mutation of H3N2, and thereby reducing the effectiveness of the vaccine. Now the present vaccine is not so protective, but it still has a certain strength in providing protection. We therefore encourage high-risk individuals to receive the vaccination. We are also trying to purchase vaccines that can deal with H3N2. But the vaccines may only can only come in April. Now there is an expert group under the Center for Health Protection, and working on a plan for providing the vaccination. Mr. Priority of provision of vaccination. I think members are paying attention to our food and health portfolio. There are comprehensive plans to deal with various matters and to enhance our food safety and enhance our healthcare service. I hope members will support the policy address and also related measures. Thank you.
That's the end of the third debate session. We now proceed to the fourth debate session. The debate themes are population, education, manpower, youth.